told me, "Don, you need to marry somebody that can do things you can't do much. You need lots of help." My spiritual gifts are pastor and teacher and hospitality. My wife's spiritual gift is found latter part of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and it's called the gift of helps. So when we were in Bible school, Diane came. I was upperclassman and she is freshman. She looked around all the school to see where could I invest my gift and be the most profitable. And she said, "I don't see anybody that needs more help than that guy right there." So here we are. It's been just a pleasure to be with you folks today. And so many of you I do not know, but because I love your pastor and his wife so much, therefore I love you, because I know he talks of you and loves you deeply. And our prayers are with them as they spend this month and gone overseas with their daughter and all the stuff that's going on in his life. And Pastor Jack Woodard, will you stand up, please? I want to see how you're dressed tonight. Is this one of your men? Deacon White, welcome tonight to this white church. Pastor Woodard, how many years you been at Straight Gate? Long time.
Since Mother's Day,
1995. 20 years. And Jack and I are great friends. Matter of fact, a lot of the preachers in this community met playing basketball at the YMCA early in the morning, and we would knock each other around playing ball, and then later we began to pray for one another because we needed healed from all of our injuries, and started pastor's prayer meeting, man, 1999 or something like that. And we drove over to Fort Wayne and drove in the parking lot. There was three or four of us at the First Assembly of God in Fort Wayne, and we were going to the Pastor's Prayer Summit. They had about 60 people who pray from all different denominations together, and Pastor Woodard came, and we have been friends ever since, and he's helped us facilitate Pastor's Prayer Summit. Matter of fact, you may not know this, but our very first Pastor's Prayer Meeting in this community, pastors from Howard, Miami, and Tipton County, was held at your church when you was in the other property. I probably shouldn't say this out loud, but I'm going home tonight, so I won't be here tomorrow. This is how your pastor opened the prayer meeting. Says you were then First General Baptist, you know. And so he said, "Okay, for all you guys who pray in tongues, it's okay to do that in this church." And I thought to myself, the Baptists can say whatever they want and get away with it. And so it is wonderful. I have to tell you, the reason I had Pastor Jack stand, I wanted to see what he had on. When I left this community in 2004, January of 04, my first time to preach to the preachers in our fellowship was in January. And Pastor Jack said to me, "I want to buy you a new suit to preach to the preachers in." And I tried to put him off kindly and said, "You know, just the thought is all that's necessary." And he said, "No, I'm going to buy you a suit." And I got more serious. I said, "And it costs you $700. You don't need to buy me a suit." And he said, "No, I'm going to buy you a suit to preach to the preachers in." And then I said, "Look, let me just be real honest with you, Pastor. Look at me. I am Caucasian. I cannot wear a suit you'd buy me." "I'm just as white as I can be. I'm sorry." Well, this is back long enough ago when Lafayette Square was still in big business over on the west side of Indianapolis, and Pastor Jack took me to the African Men's Apparel store. Now, I don't know the name of the store, but I was the only white person in there. I remember that. And he bought me a dark purple suit with dark purple stripes, pant legs about this big around, coattails down to my knees, a light purple shirt, and a tie that glows in the dark. You don't even have to plug it in. Well, I sneaked into that preacher's meeting, and I walked in, and all those people in that meeting, you know, they know me from years and years being in Indiana, and I snuck in there, and they'd never seen me dressed like that. And I walked in, and I felt, whoa. And one of our African-American preachers, he saw me, and he made a beeline right across the room to where I was. And I noticed he was staring at my shoes. And then I knew. He wants to know if the white boy had enough sense to wear the right shoes. And when he got there, I lifted up my shoes that old Pastor Jack helped me get, alligator shoes. Purple pads right in the middle. I mean, those things are awesome. And he looked at me and he was just like, wow. I thought, wow, if that's all you got to do is dress up to wow the preachers. And so I love Pastor Jack, and it's so wonderful that he would grace us tonight with his presence and be with us. And we say thank you, Pastor. Love you. This has been kind of a memory lane for me, because we started our 12th year being in Indianapolis this year, at the beginning of this year. So it's been, and so when I knew, when I called Kenny Bennett, I think I texted him or something, I'm not sure what it was, and I said, I'm going to be in Kokomo, I'd like to see you. I knew he worked Sunday morning, come over on Sunday night, and he said, well, I go to Pastor Brad's church every Sunday night. And so I said, okay, I'll be glad to see him. And Kenny was my daughter, our middle girl's first running coach at Sycamore. And I remember that. And I have run a few times with Kenny. I remember running 800s on Vail Avenue in about 2 minutes and 50 seconds, thinking, if Jesus, I better be ready to go because I'm about to die. And I remember him saying to me, get up here and relax. And I thought, if I could get up there and I had any breath left, I'd choke you to death. What do you mean relax? I'm just about to die. I won't forget that. So it's wonderful to see him. And we have some good friends in the back, the Brownings and the Becks, and Patty back here helped me raise my kids. You know, when you have little kids and you're a pastor, you need somebody in the church to help raise your kids, and she would take care of my kids and discipline my kids, and then even when they had grandkids later, she took care of them. And I remember when Jim gave his heart, Jim used to be on the police force here, to the Lord, and when Dale gave his heart to the Lord, Dale reminded me tonight that, for those of you that are timing me, this doesn't count, none of this counts. None of this counts. My friend I brought this morning gave me his chronograph watch after the service and said, you preach 65 minutes. And he wasn't even smiling when he said it. Dale reminded me when we baptized him, he's a pretty big boy. We had to have two guys help get him up out of the water. He's a big boy. And I won't ever forget, Dale, the friend of your and Tom's who gave his heart to the Lord, who had a brain tumor. And he had two rows of people who come to watch him be baptized in water. And one of the boys had gotten the baptistry and flipped the plug and drained the tank. I know who that boy is. And I had checked it Saturday night at prayer meeting. It was full. I had checked it when I came over to church that morning. For some reason, after Sunday school, I just stuck my head up over and looked to see, you know, there's water in the tank. I know, I looked at it just an hour ago. That thing was bone dry. My heart sunk, and I said, this guy, he may not be here next week. He's very, very ill. He's got two rows of people we had never seen before to see him be baptized in water. And Dale, he's not been saved very long himself at that time, and he whispered in my ear. He came up to the front where I was sitting, and he said, get those big orange containers we have in the kitchen and fill them full of water and dump it on them. I said, if you'll not tell my supervisor I did it in Springfield, I'll do it. I think that was the most powerful water baptism service we ever had. Because how many know it's the condition of your heart? Yes. So these are great people, and we're so glad to be able to see them tonight. And Charlie is here tonight, and his bride that I have not met, is it Jenna? Jen. So it's wonderful to meet her tonight, and Diane and I had joined the running and walking club, and Charlie was not a believer at that time. And he was always very nice to me, but pretty well made up his mind, you can talk about Jesus if you want to, but I ain't never wearing Jesus shirts in my life. And Charlie gave his heart to the Lord, and he's been a good friend, and we love you, Charlie. And it's so wonderful. We ran on the industrial trail this afternoon that you had a big part of making sure Kokomo had places to run and walk and exercise, and Charlie's into all those things. So it's wonderful to see these great friends tonight in this service. Would you stand with me, if you would, please? I want you to turn to the book of Revelation. My wife leaned over to me just before I got up here tonight, and she said, remember, we have to drive home tonight. What do you think she meant? I don't know what in the world she's talking about. And you didn't sing quite as long tonight, but that doesn't mean the preacher won't be as long. I don't know. We'll just have to see how it goes, all right? So those of you that are timing me, you can start now. Revelation chapter 2. Remember, we read this morning from Acts about the revival in Ephesus. So here we are, 40 to 50 years later, after that outpouring that's recorded in Acts 19. And Jesus has a word for this church. And he speaks it through John. And John is in exile for his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And John writes these words of Jesus that came directly to him. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your patience. You cannot bear those who are evil. You have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. And you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. Nevertheless, Jesus commends them, and then he zeroes in on a problem. Remember the great outpouring they had and the great revival that touched all of Asia. Nevertheless, I have this against you. You have left your first love. Doesn't say you don't love me anymore. Says you've determined to put other things ahead of me. You've left your first love. Then he says these words, remember. That's an important word in the Bible. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do your first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Father, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we sang about being your children tonight, and what a privilege to call you our Father. And so, Lord, as we gather around the table where we partake of the Word of God, will you penetrate it deep into our hearts, and Lord, impart to us truth that will transform us. For Lord, we're ever in the process of being transformed from the inside out. And impart to us, Lord, that we'll be able to impart to others, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I want to give you just a quick lesson in the book of Acts. Where we were at a leadership meeting just a few weeks ago in Branson, Missouri, and they promoted a series that's coming out. Help me, Diane. When is it coming out? Easter Sunday. It's called AD. It's 8 weeks on NBC, and it's the story of the book of Acts. And so, and for NBC to show it, I guess they got so much traction with the Bible series, NBC has picked this up. And our general superintendent had a great influence in helping them understand that if you're going to make a film about the book of Acts, you got to understand who the Holy Spirit is. And so he was very influential in the making. And we saw the first clip of Jesus' death and resurrection and the first scene while we were there. And so let me just take you. Jesus has now resurrected and he's getting ready to go back to the Father. And Luke 24 says, he said, I don't want you to leave the city until until you receive the promise of the Father, which is the gift of the Holy Spirit. And then when you get over to the book of Acts, he repeats that again, same writer, Luke, and he says, I want you to receive the promise of the Father, the gift of the Holy Spirit. When you get to Acts chapter 1, it talks about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Here it says, and this is really the theme verse for the book of Acts, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, capital M, meaning Jesus, where? Jerusalem, where? Judea, where? Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. So when you read the first 30, 40 years of the history of the church in the book of Acts, you discover Jerusalem and Judea in those first 12 chapters. And all of Jerusalem and Judea is filled with the doctrine of God. You get down there to chapter 8 and you find about the revival in Samaria. And Peter and John are called down there to pray for people to receive the infilling of the Holy Spirit in Samaria. How many remember somebody else who went to Samaria? There was a woman at the well. Jesus had already been there, and that outpouring, and then Saul on the road to Damascus at that time, who becomes the Apostle Paul, has an encounter with the presence of God. How many have ever heard the preacher say, the Holy Spirit is a gentleman? Anybody ever heard it? Not everything the preacher says is true. I wonder if Saul thought he was a gentleman when he put him on the ground and took his eyesight away from him without his permission. Blind, couldn't see until the man of God came, laid hands on him, scales fell from his eyes, and he began to be able to see, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And then it says, not only in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, but the uttermost parts of the world. And you get to the 13th chapter of the book of Acts, and you discover Paul's missionary journeys, where he takes this gospel to Macedonia, and eventually he gets all the way to Rome, and this gospel spreads everywhere. On the way, he is in Asia. This is an interesting fact to me. Paul is wanting to go to Asia, and the Bible says the Holy Spirit stops him. He turns to go to Bithynia, and the Holy Spirit stops him. And Acts chapter 16 records the great Macedonia call, come over here and help us. How many know God has a timing? I want to get in his will. You ever been out of his will? I've been out of his will before. That's why I believe the story of Jonah and the whale. It's a slimy, dark, ugly place to be out of God's will. And so Paul goes down to this great city, and revival breaks out, and God begins to stir all over Asia. Both Jews and Greeks hear the word of the Lord. And then he leaves, and we know the leadership meeting he had in chapter 20, we talked about this morning. And now he's on his way, and in Rome, from prison, he writes a follow-up letter. It's really a discipleship letter to this church in Ephesus. We call it in the New Testament the book of, it's not a trick question, Ephesians. Not a trick, trying to say he's trying to trick us. No, I'm not trying to trick you. The book of Ephesians. And that book has, we've divided it up, and man has divided it up into six chapters. The first three tell how to believe, how to continue to believe. The last three tell how to behave. And how many think maybe what we say we believe, our behavior should back up what we say we believe? Belief and behavior have always went together. Now Paul's getting older, and he's getting ready to turn over to a younger preacher. And he writes to that young preacher, Timothy, who he turns the revival of Asia over to. And he says to him, 2 Timothy, I have fought the good fight. How many know what a good fight is? It's one you win. Yeah. Right? Yeah. It's not a good fight if you don't win. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but to all who love his appearing. Now, 40 years after Acts 19, 40 to 50 years, Jesus has a word for this church. Matter of fact, he has seven words to seven churches. All of them began with, to the angel of the church of. Here we're reading to the angel of the church of Ephesus. All of them have a word to their church. So how many would think, because of everything that went on in Ephesus, that's a pretty important place? But can I tell you, Jesus is building his church in Ephesus, in Kokomo, in Howard County, in Indianapolis. He has a word for every one of his churches. I wonder if Jesus wrote a letter to us tonight, what would he commend us for? What would he say? Good job. I commend you. What might he warn us about? To five of the churches out of the seven, you have the word repent or repentance. Would he be asking me to repent from something? I wonder. I think probably that he would. The thing that excites me when I read this, it says Jesus holds the seven stars. Who are the seven stars? They are the messengers of the church. Whether it's an angelic messenger breathing help to the leader of the church, aren't you glad that Jesus holds the messengers of the church in his right hand? That's the hand of blessing. That's the hand of presence and power. There is protection in his hand. Not just for the leaders of the church, but you and I are engraved in the palm of his hand. And this is what excites me. It says Jesus walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. What are the lampstands? They're the churches. Don't you like it when Jesus comes to your church? You know, he wants to come to everybody's church. He wants, but not everybody's church wants him there. You get to one place recorded in Revelation chapter 3, and they're having church, and Jesus is on the outside, and he's knocking, saying, you know what? I'd like to get into this church. They don't even pay any attention. I don't want to get to that place. And this is what I've been feeling like for the last 3 years. This has been boiling in me. I do not want to lose our lampstand. I'm reading in the Old Testament again, and I'm reading about the priests who continually trim and make sure there's oil to keep the lamp lit. What does it say? Continuously. I don't want the lamp to be snuffed out of our local churches or our fellowship of believers and great groups of people. I want us to have a lampstand that burns bright. I don't want to do anything. Here in Ephesus, he said, if you don't repent, I'm going to remove your lampstand from its place. Unless you repent. Those are pretty strong words. I'm concerned about the church. How many know the church is getting older? The fellowship that I'm a part of is now 100 years old as of this year. So we're older than we used to be. I went to the doctor a few years ago and he found a hole in my heart. And I had to get a procedure to get that thing plugged up. And I said, how long have I had that hole in my heart? He said, your whole life. I said, well, why am I having trouble now? And he said these famous words, you're older now. And I said to him, Dr. Fry, how much is that going to cost me, that great wisdom you just laid on me that made me feel so good about myself? You're older now. So Jesus has a word to say to this church, to the leadership he holds in his hand, to the church where he desires to walk in their midst. Each of the letters say these words. He who has a ear, let him what?
Hear.
I want to suggest to you that we have a speaking God. So therefore, I need to be a hearing person. I need to be able to hear what Jesus is saying. Jesus is praying for me, so I want to know, what is it he's praying for? I want to pray what he prays. The Hebrew writer, three times, listen to this, Hebrews 3:7. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice... Do not what? Do you remember? Do not harden your heart as in the day of rebellion, in the trial in the wilderness. Chapter 3, verse 15, he says, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Chapter 4, verse 7, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your heart. I want to suggest to you, according to Hebrews in the book of Revelation, here is a very important word. Do not harden your heart. And when I looked up that word hardened, I began to realize that it means don't let your heart become fossilized. So a gal who is still an intercessor for me, and she makes things for me, she gave me this fossil. I wish I had 725 of these for all my preachers to give it to them. I want you to look at that. This is indented and raised, and it fits perfectly together. I have no idea how long it took to create this fossil. This obviously is a plant that at one time was living, but it's now been fossilized inside this rock. You know what I'm concerned about? I'm concerned about the church, that we don't have the leftovers of yesterday, and we don't have the appearance of life, but that we have real life. I don't want my life to be, this is what yesterday was, but I want a today relationship with the Lord. I want to be able to hear. I don't want to have a hard heart. I want to be tender to hear what the Lord is saying to us. So he has a word for this church, and he says to them, I want you to remember. When I first moved to Indianapolis, I always had an office in the church, and now I have an office at home in the basement, and I have an office at the office, and I got books in both places and computers in both places, and so I still don't know where everything is even after 11 years. And so I thought, well, because I don't live next door to the church anymore, if I forget something, it takes a long time to go back and get it. So I stacked up all my study books to take home, and I put them in the entry of the doorway. So I'd trip over them on the way out. How many understand what I just said? I didn't want to forget. So I got ready to go, and I walked out that door. And when I walked out that door, I said, whoa, I didn't trip over my books. And the girls in the office said, oh, we saw that mess, and we cleaned it up for you. I said, oh, don't clean up my mess. I won't know where anything is if you clean up my mess. We have a counter in our house that after a while, my wife has got all she can take. And everything on the counter that I've been bringing home all week goes through what I call the giant sweep. I may never see those things again the rest of my life. So Jesus says to this church, remember from where you have fallen. Repent and do your first works, or else I will come quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. And so I said to the Lord, Lord, what were they supposed to remember? Have you ever asked questions like that when you're reading your Bible? No, I wasn't there. Some people think you might have been there. I wasn't there. They knew what they were supposed to remember, but I don't know what they were supposed to remember. When those words are written, they know what they're supposed to remember. So I prayed and I asked the Holy Spirit, remember what? And I felt the Holy Spirit say, if you want to know what they should remember, I want you to go back and study Acts 18, 19, and 20 and find out what happened, and then you'll know what you should remember. If you want to know what they should remember, go back to the book of Ephesians and read that book that I wrote to them, and you will discover what I want them to remember. So I'm in my basement, and I just take a little bit of time, and I thought, well, remember. And so I go back to the book of Ephesians, and I'm not going to preach the book of Ephesians. I know some of you are fearful, but I just want to make a couple highlights. I need to remember what? Ephesians 1, that we exist as a body to express Christ's fullness on this earth. The uniting of Jew and Gentile. All races, all tribes, all languages. We are one body representing Jesus in this world. Now, I am the son of Arkansas cotton farmers. My mom and dad were raised on the cotton farm. My grandpa and grandpa were cotton farmers. How many know that there might have been a little prejudice in those days? So my son adopts an African-American girl in Hammond when he's worship pastor. And for the first time, we have color in our family. She said to me, she's 15, she said, "I'm going to marry me a light-colored chocolate man." That's what she said. She just said that. And she married a boy from Jamaica. And he is as dark as my coat. Travis. I said, "Travis, the lights are low at this wedding. You smile, boy. Nobody's going to see you." I mean, that's how black he is. So I have an African-American granddaughter and an African-American or Jamaican grandson. My daughter that we told you about the miracle that she's received, her and her husband adopt three little children. They all have the same mom, but they all have different dads. The boy's dad is from Pakistan, and the girl's dads are Mexican, Hispanic. So therefore, now I have Pakistan and Hispanic in my family, and I have this Arkansas cotton farmer's kid has an international family. And how many know that's what the body of Christ is, representing Jesus around this world? All of us. All of us. What am I supposed to remember? We are one in the Lord Jesus Christ. I need to remember that. I'll never forget when we first started pastor's prayer meeting in this community. We went to Howard Miami Mennonite Church with Lee Miller, who would be here tonight, but he's out of town. And Lee's my good friend. And I'll never forget, there's 15 or 20 of us gathering at noon at his church. And those Mennonite gals, buddy, they can cook. Oh, wow. And one of those gals had made a homemade loaf of bread. Big loaf, and we used it for communion at their church. And Lee split that thing in the middle, and when you opened it up, it was still warm. And it had all the different little colors of grains in it, of the bread. And in tears coming down his face, he said, "There was a day that I wouldn't have been able to let any of you on the platform of this Mennonite church, but that day is over, and today we are like this bread. We are many different specks and many different backgrounds, but we are one loaf, one body of Christ." Yeah. And he stood there and cried and gave that revelation, and I was just dumbfounded. I said, "I didn't know that God could speak to Mennonites. I didn't know." And then notice in Ephesians 1, it says we are adopted. Remember that word in Ephesians? What do I need to remember? We are adopted. A year ago, last October, our daughter adopted these three little children. And so I learned a lot about adoption that I did not know. First time I'd ever been to a ceremony, an adoption ceremony. So the judge comes out, and you can change the children's names. They all get new social security numbers and a new identity. So Tyler is the oldest, and the judge reads the paper, and Megan changes his middle name to his dad's middle name. And their last name is Kreger. So the judge signs the paper where his social security number has been changed, and he says, "You are now Tyler Michael Kreger," and the mallet comes down. Boom! And everybody's crying. And the attorneys are crying, and the social workers are crying. And if Mike had have been there, he'd have been crying, because that's his job. And that's the reward of his job, if you get to see kids get a good home. And then Bethany comes out and she takes on her Nana's middle name, and the judge says, you are now Bethany Renee Krieger. Boom, the mallet goes, and more tears. And then the baby, who happens to be a girl. How many understand what I just said? And she takes on her mom's middle name, and you are now Molly Nicole Krieger, and the mallet comes down, and we're wailing by now. And for the first time in my life, I began to understand, I need to remember that when I gave my life to Jesus, I received a new social security number. I received a new identity. I have been given a new name that is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm not who I used to be. I'm brand new and becoming more brand new every day. Amen. It's incredible, isn't it? I need to remember where I've come from. I'm not that person anymore. Charlie, you're not that person anymore. Thank God. Wow. Lorene's husband, Gary, came back to the Lord later in his life, and the Gary I knew was not the Gary that other people knew. And people would say to me, I said, this is the Gary. And I say, no. I said, no, you don't understand. This is a new Gary. I want to tell you something about Gary that just comes to my mind. This is why my sermons are so long. When you get older, you tell stories. God was speaking things to Gary, and I thought it was amazing how many things God spoke to that man that he knew, that I knew he couldn't know. And then one day, he said, the Holy Spirit said to me, I'm going to stop speaking to you like that. And I thought, what did he do? Watch some preacher on TV and he's got into error. What happened to him? What do you mean? God's not going to. He said, the Lord told me, I want you to start reading the Bible. I'm speaking through my son in the Word of God. I want you to understand. That's some of the last things you did together. Make sure you read your Bible, even when Gary wasn't able to read for himself. New creatures. I need to remember. I need to remember that a husband is to love his wife, yes, and a wife is to respect her husband. I need to remember that God wants to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the children to the father. I need to remember that I need to provide for my kids and that children are to honor and respect their mom and dad. This is a nation, if they could understand, how many know the commandments are given to you for our own good? Yes. Not to penalize us. But for our own, we think the law is so terrible. The law is not terrible. Lawbreakers are terrible. But God's moral laws have not changed from generation to generation. You read about Exodus chapter 20, God's laws, moral laws, are the same. You get to Deuteronomy chapter 4, everybody has died in the wilderness, and the only two to make it in is Joshua and Caleb, and he rehearses the law to the next generation, and God's moral law had not changed at all. And when you get to the New Testament, Jesus didn't change it, he just increased it. God's word. Things that I need to remember. I need to remember that he created us male and female. In today's world, that's a confusing point to some people. I need to remember. Toward the end of the book of Ephesians, he talks that we are ambassadors for Christ, and at the end of the armor of God passage, he talks to us about speaking boldly or fearlessly about the Lord Jesus Christ. I live in a cul-de-sac on the west side of Indianapolis, and I'm not home as much as I want to be, but I have several neighbors in the cul-de-sac, and one of the first things we started doing was my granddaughter would come over on Christmas, and her and Nana would bake cookies, and we'd put them in 10 pans, and we'd take them around and take hot cookies to all of our neighbors in the cul-de-sac. And I remember I took them over to Brian, who lives next to me on the left, and he felt the pan. He said, are these still warm? I said, yes. He said, thank you, and shut the door. My African-American family across the street, the oldest boy is Kevin. He was real little. And I used to take him out. I bought a basketball goal, you know, with the thumb drive. And when he was younger, I'd take him out there and whip him in basketball. When he got older, I quit playing. I took him cookies over to his family, and one day he was out shoveling his drive, and so I went over to help him shovel his drive. And I said, "Did you get any of those big oatmeal chocolate chip cookies that we made for your family?" He said, "What cookies?" I said, "We had 6 or 7 of them for everybody in the family." He said, "What cookies?" He said, "They gave me none." So I called Diane on the cell phone. I said, "Heat up a couple of those cookies in the microwave, and I'll come get them, and I'll give them to Kevin. I had 3 great big honker cookies." And I gave them to him. I said, "You know, that's enough for you to share with your sisters." He said, "I'm sharing with nobody. I'm not sharing with nobody." Stood right there. I might eat it all right out here. Well, my neighbor to the right, I thought they were all Jewish, a Jewish family. The boy went to the Jewish school, and I knew Melody was Jewish. And I always thought that her husband was Jewish. And he wouldn't respond to me for years. He'd just kind of grunt at me. I'd go to try to help him shovel his drive, and he'd kind of shoo me off. And I don't think he said 5 words to me in the first 8-9 years that I lived there. And I do a lot of prayer walking in our neighborhood. And how many know prayer changes atmosphere? And I'm coming in from a prayer walk, and I'm going by his house, and he walks right out into the sidewalk and pours his life out to me. And I said, You don't go to the synagogue?" He said, "Oh, no." He said, "Last time I went to church, I was a little boy, and my mom took me to a Christian church." And I said, would you ever come, if I ever preached close to where we live, would you come to the service?" So I was at the Lakeview Church on 465 a year ago, September, and he came. My neighbors to the left, they had 2 services, and I was going to a staff retreat, so I couldn't bring him to church. I couldn't take him out to lunch. I couldn't do everything you're supposed to do when you bring people. You don't ask them to come, you bring them. And when church is over, you take them out to eat and you pay the bill. Now, your pastor told me to tell you that. No, he didn't. He didn't tell you. But I know he would tell me. And so I said to my neighbors, "Don't tell your pastor, but would you leave your church one Sunday? Bring him to church and take him out to eat afterward." Well, he came to the second service with my neighbors, and they said, "We'd like to see what you do anyway. We'd like to see what you do when you leave every week and run around all over, and you come home late on Sunday afternoon, and we want to see, and we want your wife to sing. We'd like to hear her sing." So he came and he raised his hand at the altar call. I'll never forget it. I began to cry. I could feel, I thought, "Oh my, I'm going to break down in front of all these people." And but he didn't come forward to accept Christ. And I greeted him after the service, and I had to head right on the other side of the state for another meeting. I didn't see him for a whole week. And I'm preaching somewhere else, and I'm coming in late Sunday afternoon. First time I've seen him since he's been in the service. And he's out in his yard working. And I went over and I said, "Eric, it was so great to have you in church." I said, "How did you enjoy it?" He said, "It was awesome." He said they had screens, big screens. He said they had guitars and drums. He said it was awesome. And I thought to myself, well, it's not awesome everywhere I go, but. And I said, "I noticed you raise your hand, and I know you've been thinking about this a long time. Are you ready to accept the gift of eternal life?" And he said, "What do I got to do? Just tell me and I'll do it." I thought to myself, can't be this easy. And I shared the gospel with him, got ready to pray with him. He said, wait a minute. And I thought, what is he doing? He ran in the house, and when he came back out, I noticed he'd washed his hands. He was all muddy from working in here. So he cleaned up before he got cleaned up. Isn't that something? And he put this note in my mailbox just a few weeks later. He said, "Thank you so very much for the prayer book and the reading guide and the scrumptious cookies. I read 30 pages the first night, and I'm further along now. I greatly appreciate everything you've done for me, especially helping me accept Christ in my life. Enjoy the holidays. Have a wonderful new year." And he signs it. So last summer, I got sick, and I went to the emergency room twice, and I haven't been in the hospital overnight more than 2 or 3 times my whole life. And so Diane put a little note out to the cul-de-sac families that Don's in the hospital to pray for him. And so he gets it, and I'm only in there about 24 hours. And I'm getting ready to go home, and there he is standing at my door in the hospital. And I said, "What are you doing here?" He said, well, your wife said, pray for you. He said, I just want to come up and see you. He said, I'm not very good at this pray thing out loud. I said, I want to pray for you, but he said, I can't. I'm not very good at praying. He said, so I wrote a prayer to the Lord here. He gives it to me. So I'm sitting on the side of my bed. I still got my gown on, looking awesome and uncovered. And he says, dear Lord, please help Don feel better at your earliest opportunity. Don't you love new converts?
Yes.
They're so honest and so real. And I'm already crying. I'm reading that. I said, oh, Jesus. And then he says, we miss his positive energy on the court already. Don helped me find you, or I might still be lost. You've helped many others find and better understand your teachings. And I really like this. I like this guy. Listen to what he says. If you just take the smallest portion of his love and dedication for you that he shares in his powerful sermons. Wow, I like people who like my preaching. Not everybody does. And that should be more than enough to help Don feel better. Isn't that awesome? What do I need to remember? I am an ambassador in chains. I am to boldly and fearlessly proclaim the name of the Lord. And it isn't just in words you say. It's in deed you do. Because last winter was so hard. How many remember last winter? Oh, I didn't think it was ever going to get over. And my wife is concerned about me shoveling everybody's driveway. I'm not as old as Charlie, but she thinks I'm getting pretty old. So she don't want me to have a... Pardon? Not far behind, I know. I'm not always, when we ran races, I wasn't far behind him, but he's tall enough that he was kind of a road sign. I never would, only time I ever got lost is when I was ahead of him at a race, and you remember that, don't you? And so I bought me a snowblower and had it in the garage for weeks and never got to start it up because we didn't have any snow. It's got the big tires, you know, double blades. I've been sitting out the garage. And so I've been running around the neighborhood, just plowing the walks and plowing everybody's drive. And my neighbors are sending me little coffee cakes and writing little thank you notes and saying, Mr. G, thanks, you know. You know what? Just be a believer. You fearlessly proclaim the word of the Lord, not just by your words, but by who you are. So when Jesus says to this church, remember therefore from where you have fallen, don't forget where you used to be and what Jesus did for you. And he can do that for anybody else. Saul said of himself, he was the chiefest of sinners. I don't know if it was you, Mike, or somebody. You remember Mark Rowe, who came into the running club. And somebody said to me, he's an atheist. You won't ever make him a believer. I don't make anybody a believer. You just be their friends. And I got to baptize Mark in water in the last few weeks that I lived in this town. And several months ago, he wrote me. I don't even know where he lives now. He's moved away somewhere in Michigan. And he wrote me a note and said, do you have a good recommendation for a Bible study book we could do for our Bible study? Listen, everybody's just one moment away from their life being transformed. We need to remember. Now, how long have I been going? Anybody's timing me? My wife has said a while. So I'm gonna come to the end. Right now I'm gonna skip all the middle and come to the end. You know what else I need to remember? I need to remember Acts 19, where Paul comes to Ephesus and said, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? The church was birthed in the manifested presence of God. I need to remember that. And then the Bible says in Acts 19, they did extraordinary miracles. The church was birthed in the power of God. The presence of God and the power of God to do supernatural things. Peter and John could say to the lame man outside the gate, beautiful, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have. You can't give it if you don't have it.
That's right.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we're married and our wife has all the money, but we do have something we can give you. Now, the text doesn't say that, but that's how I read it. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the Bible says immediately his ankle bones began to receive strength and he leaped to his feet. And if you read the text, he goes into the synagogue, dancing and leaping and praising God. Now, the text doesn't say this, but I've been in church. My mother carried me to church before I came out into this world. So I've been in church my whole life. I know this happens in church. I'm sure when that old boy went into the synagogue and was dancing, somebody criticized him.
Oh, yes.
Somebody criticized him. You need to be careful about criticizing people who have physical responses to the presence of God. If you had never walked in your life and you could walk instantaneously without physical therapy in a moment's time, you would dance in church too. And think about it, without physical therapy, he did it. Some of you understand what I just said.
Yes.
The tissues and the muscles would be deteriorated. There would be nothing there. We've been through some of that. I remember in 1991, after a great number of months, Diane flat on her back, couldn't lift her legs that far off the bed. Could not set up, could not put her legs down. I carried her around on sheets and carried her in the back of my van and had a reclining wheelchair and pushed her in and out of church for a long time. And I remember the Saturday night that it was late at night in the parsonage, and she had graduated to a bedside commode. And that's big progress. Some of you don't think it is, but it is. But she still couldn't stand on her feet, weight bearing. And I said that night, "Can you stand on your feet by yourself?" She said, "I don't know." And she stood for the first time. I said, "You think you could take a step?" And I put a chair out in front of her. Not the chairs I have in the living room that I told you about this morning with no arms. Chairs that have arms on them that are useful. And she put her arms on there and she took one step. And then she took another step and she walked over to the fireplace and walked back to her. We didn't have a worship band. We didn't have any drummers. We didn't have any screams, but we had some loud noises going on in our house.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And I thought, tomorrow is church, and I get to stand Diane up and let her walk. And then this little thing came over me. It's called orneriness. I've been the pastor of that church for 14 years. And nobody waited till Sunday to tell me anything. If they wanted to tell me at 3:00 in the morning, they rang my phone. And they said, "You got to get to the hospital. So-and-so's only going to live an hour." And I would think, "You don't know that. You don't hold the keys.
That's right. Come on.
My marriage has been falling apart for 49 years. But if you don't come tonight, we're not going to make it till tomorrow." I've been getting those calls for 14 years, all night long. And I thought, you know what? I'm getting out my little Rolodex and I'm calling everybody in the church and I'm saying, "Get out of the bed. How dare you sleep when God's doing a miracle in my house?" It felt so good to teach those people, you reap what you sow. I can see those team of 10 doctors standing around her bed saying, "You may never walk again. I'd like to see you outwalk her in a road race. I've had some hamstring problems and I finally quit running and I went to the physical therapist and he told me that my hamstring was pulling because my lower back and my glutes were weak. And if I would strengthen my lower back and my glutes," and you know, glutes is a famous word, fancy word for something else. So I went. And so I started going to the LA Fitness where she'd been going. She had a trainer and he was helping her be mobile and be strong. And so I just went with her and I saw what she did and I did what she did. After I went home, I woke up the next morning and I walked around like this. And that boy Ryan, his arms as big as my thighs, he said to me, "Now Don, you can't just go do what your wife's been working up to. You're not up to it." That was real encouraging to my ego. The other day, the grandkids were over, and one of my granddaughters said to her Nana, she got ready for bed, she said, "Nana, you're starting to have guns." And she said, "We don't have guns. We've never had guns in our house." She said, "No, your arms, you're getting guns in your arms." You know, I'm grateful for physicians and medicine and all that stuff, but the great physician has the final word. I need to remember his presence and his power. And I close with this. Acts 19 says toward the end of the chapter, or the middle of the chapter, and they came confessing, telling their deeds. And they had a big bonfire, and they burned up all of the occult stuff that they had, and the things that were evil in their life. And they turned totally away from sin. I need to remember His presence, His power, and His purity. He calls us to behave like we say we believe. So when Jesus says to this church, remember therefore from where you have fallen, I need to have big ears. Can you show that picture? I found these. We need to have big spiritual ears. If they can find that picture, I took a couple pictures off the internet. Show the other one, will you please? You can't see it very well because the lights are so on. You know what I need? I need spiritual ears that I can hear. And I need them to renew my mind so I'll remember. And when Paul says, put on the whole armor of God, you know how you put it on? You put it on in prayer and supplication, praying always in the Spirit. That's how you put the armor of God on. I need to remember. Amen? I want us to stand together, please. I'd like for heads to be bowed for just a moment. If someone could come and just play real softly for me, please. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5 and 6, these words, test yourselves to make sure you're solid in the faith. Don't drift along taking everything for granted. Give yourself regular checkups. You need firsthand evidence, not mere hearsay, that Jesus Christ is in you. Test it out. If you fail the test, do something about it. I hope the test won't show that we have failed. We're rooting for truth to win out in you. I need to remember. I need to remember. I know this morning we had a strong response to the altar, and it may be that you were here and you needed to respond and you didn't, or maybe there are those in this house tonight that you weren't here this morning. What would Jesus commend you for? What would He say good? Or would there be some things that He says you need to repent of? Some things you need to admit to and confess to. 5 out of the 7 churches, He had to say, repent. What is Jesus saying? I'm studying right now a book called The 8th Letter. Jesus is still speaking to His church today, to us. If you're here tonight and you'd say, I know there's some things that need to be right in my life before God, and you'd just slip up your hands real quick and say, I need prayer tonight. I need to confess some things. Just put up your hand real quick to say, I need forgiveness. God bless you. Others, God bless you. The Lord bless you. I'm going to ask us tonight, because I feel like the Lord has specifically told me how to conclude this service. But for those few who have raised their hand tonight, can we pray together out loud, church? Mean it in our heart. Not only forgiveness, but Jesus, change my life, transform my life. Can we pray together, Father in heaven? Thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, thank you that you came and paid for my sin. I admit my need. I confess my need. Forgive me. Jesus, come into my life. Change me. Give me a new social security number. A new name. Transformation. I accept you, Jesus, as my Lord. I'm free to say yes to righteousness and no to temptation. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to do 2 things before we close this service tonight. I need to remember if Jesus saved me, he can save anybody. I need to also remember that if God forgives me, I need to forgive myself. Don't carry condemnation. And if God can save you, he can save unsaved family members in your household. We're living in a generation of many kids who have walked away from the Lord, who don't know Jesus. And I felt like the Holy Spirit wanted us to pray for two things specifically. One is, if you have unsaved family members, siblings, grandchildren, children, that they don't know Jesus and they've walked away from God, and you remember what Jesus did for you, he can do for them. Would you just slip up your hands and we say, I have family members, people close to us that need to know Jesus. Wow. It's almost everybody in the room. Almost everybody in the room. Wow. Holy Spirit, we collectively pray together that you would lift blinders off of their eyes. And Lord, you would send godly influences. May they suddenly be awakened to their senses that they need to come home to Jesus. Lord, we remember who you are and what you have done for us. And we pray your manifest power would wake them up out of their sleep. And you would send somebody to be their friend, to speak into their life so they can be transformed by your presence and by your power. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I felt the Holy Spirit speak this to me about this time. We need to remember that we serve a God who cares about his kids. My wife and I have experienced many miracles. Jack, you're a miracle tonight. God has healed you. Healed you. Made you a new person. Created health in your physical body. Many of us he's brought healing to. I want to take time to pray for those tonight. You say, I'm God's kid. I want you to be able to pull yourself up into his lap and let him put his hands on you and touch you. And tonight, as we pray for people who need healing, I'm not just talking about physical healing, but I'm talking about emotional and mental healing. I really think much of our physical ailments are due to wounds that have come to our soul, to our emotions and our mind. Things that have happened that have hurt us, crushed us. Probably everybody in this room has lived long enough to know that life's not always fair. But we also know God's always good. And so tonight, if you need healing, I want you to picture this. Jesus was pierced in his side. Blood and water poured out. I want to tell you, he's purchased the price for your healing on the inside. If you need healing in your physical body, his back was broken, bleeding. Not only that you might be forgiven of your sins, but you might be healed of all your diseases. Psalm 103, his benefit, forgive us of all of our iniquities, heals all of our diseases. I trust him. I recognize that there comes a place where we'll leave this old world and we'll leave this body. I understand that. But I also know our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost, and if he's not through with you yet, and it's not time for you to go home, he wants you to be well so you can do everything you can do for him. Be whole, be well. So how many are here tonight and you need the Lord to bring healing to you? Would you just come and stand with us right here at the front, please? I'm going to ask my wife to join me. Pastor Jack and our deacon, will you come? And I want you to help us to pray. If you need healing in your body tonight, you might need to come and sit on the front row because it's hard for you to stand. We want to pray for you tonight. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Please come. Pastor Jack, please come. Your deacon, come. Come, sir. I'm going to ask these men to start at this end, and my wife is going to join me, and we're going to do what the Bible says. The Bible says, call for the elders of the church. And so we're here tonight, and you've stepped forward. That's your call. Called for the elders. We're going to anoint you with oil. Prayer of faith is going to be prayed. The Lord's going to hear. Forgive us and bring healing tonight. Amen. So, Pastor and your deacon, would you just begin to anoint people right here? Thank you, Lord. I'm going to ask Diane to anoint our ladies tonight. I'm going to ask the church to begin to pray for these who are here. And you may feel led of the Lord to join us. Maybe the Lord has used you in gifts of healings and gift of faith. Would you just come?